What's up, everybody?
Welcome to our first episode of the Daily Gaming News.
Yes, happy to be here. Keeping the train rolling.
Yeah, keep that train rolling. Should we get right into it?
Let's dive right in.
All right, so our first topic of today is an open world cyberpunk FPS called Sin for PC and consoles was announced by Tencent, and it looks crazy.
So, yesterday, Tencent Games hosted its annual conference, and it announced a new cyberpunk-style project codenamed Sin.
The game is in development at Tencent's Lightspeed and Quantum Studios and is an open-world FPS for both PC and consoles. There was no mention during the presentation of which consoles are being targeted specifically. That being said, it was mentioned that the game will be globally marketed, and the trailer was in English, which means that we can expect it to come to both North America and Europe.
And the trailer itself was defined as a tech demo for the game, and it was really impressive, not to mention a bit crazy. We get to see a rather imposing cybernetic animal pets and character creation featuring really beautiful hair achieved in collaboration with Epic Games.
The pets themselves can be customized both in looks and traits. The video features vehicles that can be personalized as well in real time while rendered in the game's open world.
Let's check out the trailer. Everything, remember, is a work in progress, so the game may change quite a bit before it sees the light of day.
Let's check out that trailer.
Welcome to Tencent Lightspeed Studios SYN, a tech demo for a globally marketed PC and console open world FPS game. Everything you see in this demo is not final. We tried to push forward state-of-the-art, real-time graphics in a cyberpunk-style world with an intriguing universe
so cool.
And striking visuals.
She does. That's like a Harley Quinn vibe going on.
Yeah.
Can't wait to have my own robotic pet.
Right?
Our characters are realistic yet stylish, with various customization features including cosmetics, skins, and extremely realistic hair effects achieved with our strand-based hair system through cooperation with Epic Games.
The detail on the character creation is just amazing already.
She's so hardcore! Even like all the graphics with the background and the environment like already look really good.
It really does. Oh, what? Giant Robo Bear! Yeah, Ray, I agree.
Players can choose to play as one of three factions, along with their very own cybernetic pet. Each with their own unique customized
the
looks.
Fauxhawk on the bear.
Our immersive character and vehicle selection and customization process.
Nice, GTA!
Takes place within our open world universe, so characters can interact with their environment.
You can already see the amount of detail
in real time by users.
They're working on for this game.
Even the way like the light hits the vehicle and the shading is, it looks really smooth.
Yeah. And for a world like this, you really want, as at least for me, I want to be able to do this amount of customization.
For real.
This concludes our presentation. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it.
Coombs, I totally want the panda as well.
What do we think?
I'm just, you know, I'm mesmerized by games like this, right? Because I think when I saw Blade Runner as a kid, and I just remember thinking about this kind of like near future reality. Mm-hmm. I was always like, what would it be like to live in that that world, you know, to be what version of myself would I be in that world? And it feels like what Tencent Games is doing with Sin is just that.
It does. And at first I was like, oh, they're making a cyberpunk clone, like, why would you compete with cyberpunk? But looking at that, I was like, oh, that is why you would compete with cyberpunk. And it looks like a, you know, like a great standalone game, like, no, regardless of if it is similar to cyberpunk or not. And I don't think that CD Projekt Red should be necessarily worried, because it seems that cyberpunk has such like a diehard fan base already. But I think that this is a cool alternative, and I really hope we see more games in this style and in this kind of cyberpunk world.
Yeah, I feel like with cyberpunk, when you see that, you know, it's like a dark reality. You know, it's one with a lot of oppression and suffering, and, you know, the body modification and the aspect of integration with technology in society is more of kind of like a form of escape and protection and survival. Mm-hmm. Whereas this didn't really like give that kind of vibe, you know, like this gave it more of the kind of like, maybe this is more of like one of those like calmer, more fun universes and not as dark as cyberpunk.
Right, it does feel more like a fun, like maybe even a shooter, but like the animals were modified to seem like they looked cool, and it was like maybe more armor on them, but it wasn't like, oh, illegal, like black market, like you have to like kill someone to do your, what was it called, the mind or like the oh, dream? The
dreamscape or something like
yeah.
that?
Yeah. And it wasn't like nearly as dark and gritty. It does seem, you know, a lot more lighthearted.
Yeah. And then this, you asked the question too, and it makes about, are we going to see more of this? And I hope to see more of this. Is this something that, you know, should CD Projekt Red be worried?
I don't think so, because it's so different, but I will say that I don't think that there's a price point announced for this game yet, since it's still in development, but if it can undercut Cyberpunk 2077, maybe it'll, you know, take some of that, you know, market away that might have like waited for the Cyberpunk game. I think that what's worrying to me, I guess, is that Cyberpunk has been in development since 2014 or something. It's been in development for quite a while, and maybe a long time has been spent on this game, but the feeling is it looked like it was whipped up pretty fast. And, you know, it to be able to get to where it is with graphics and how it looks and the smoothness, it seems like maybe they had a head start by, you know, seeing the aesthetic that Cyberpunk already provided and kind of working off of that in just for like the feel and the tone of this game. But I think that CD Projekt Red did the legwork of creating what a cyberpunk world looks like, and these other games do get to, you know, have an advantage because of that.
Yeah. So to answer some of the questions, Orpheus and Coombs and Kai, thank you for the purple suit comment. the game you saw there is currently called Syn, S-Y-N, and what everybody's just saying is it is the open world cyberpunk FPS that is coming out by Tencent Games, and I also really, you know, paid attention to that little cliff note about they worked with Epic Games for some of the character customization. And that makes sense, because they have a large hand, you know, working with Epic and making sure, you know, they have the financial backing to really maintain the amount of people who love Epic Games' content. So it makes sense that Epic would turn around and be like, hey, here's this aspect of character creation that we've already done so well.
I wonder what Epic's full involvement in this game is, because at this time I do really trust Epic Games to, you know, deliver a good game, a game that works well, that runs smoothly. I have a lot of faith in what they do over at Epic Games. And that's a good point, that it is important that there is that collaboration as well. What this means for cyberpunk games in the future, I hope that this doesn't become kind of like an empty trend where if you create any game that looks cool without any substance, it's going to be popular.
Yeah, I think there was a period of time where we saw just too many World War II shooters, too many Vietnam shooters. There just kind of came to this place where we were just maybe felt watered down by it, and games didn't feel as, you know, full. They just felt like they were just trying to make money. And yeah, I agree with you. It's like, I really hope we avoid that with this setting, because this setting, if done right, can be one that is very impactful on a lot of levels of gaming, from storytelling to mechanics. And then also now looking at open world aspects, I mean, I think an MMO is not too far away from something like this.
I don't think so either. And this game from Tencent is going to be an open world game as well, similar to how Cyberpunk is open world, which is a massive undertaking, especially with graphics that are that advanced. To have open world is something that I think we're going to see a lot more with next gen consoles because the hardware can actually handle it.
Yeah, and that's something too, as you said, is like, and that's what we've always been excited about when we talk about the PlayStation 5 and we talk about the Xbox Series X and just kind of the integration of ray tracing and the amount of like information next gen consoles are going to be able to process.
Mm-hmm.
What level of creativity will they allow us to go into where will you want to leave the house or will you just want to, you know, play around in the Oasis? So.
Definitely. So I am looking forward to, you know, when Sin comes out from Tencent. We have a lot of thoughts on Tencent games that we'll probably go into on a later episode, but just based on the gameplay trailer that we've seen of this game, or really the work in progress of gameplay in this game, I'm very much looking forward to it.
Yeah, absolutely. And excited to see more outside of just the character creation and the gameplay itself. But this next story that we have for you is actually a really interesting one, but I think it also comes as no surprise when you know the gravity of the story of Disco Elysium, is that Disco Elysium is getting a TV series adaptation, and it's in the works from the Sonic the Hedgehog producer.
So Disco Elysium is the hit role-playing game by developer ZAUM, and it is getting the TV series treatment. The game, first released in October 2019 on PC, is based on the universe introduced in Robert Kurvitz's 2013 novel, Sacred and Terrible Air.
Disco Elysium is a groundbreaking role-playing game where you play as a detective with a unique skill system at your disposal and a whole city block to carve your path across, interrogate unforgettable characters, crack murders, or take bribes, become a hero or an absolute disaster of a human being. This story-rich game received widespread critical acclaim, including 4 wins at the Game Awards, 3 BAFTA Awards, and the honor of being named as one of the best games of the decade by Time Magazine.
Developer ZAUM has partnered with the production company DJ2 Entertainment to develop a series based on the game. No writer is currently attached, nor is a network or streaming service, but DJ2 is now meeting writers in anticipation of pitching the property later this year.
DJ2 CEO and founder Dimitri M. Johnson stated that Disco Elysium is a phenomenal property with an expansive world and unlimited potential. The DJ2 team is truly thrilled about this extraordinary opportunity to be a part of it.
Johnson was a co-producer on the film adaptation of Sonic the Hedgehog, which is the highest grossing video game-based feature film of all time. The company is executive producing several television series now in development and is producing live-action adaptations of the video games Sleeping Dogs and Echo.
Did you get a chance to play this?
I did. I played about an hour of this game, and it's so dark and so, it's like rooted in such despair that I had to stop playing it because it was just like, I was like, I don't know if I can play this game right now. I'm not in the headspace to be in this game. Did you play this?
Yeah. I saw people play it, and I paid attention to some of the streams, and especially around the Game Awards when they were, you know, hinting at this possibly taking a nomination. And that's all I remember hearing was like, this world is dark and is like perfectly suited for like an HBO, Netflix
yes.
type place. And this doesn't surprise me as they already put in so much content for storytelling. I don't think the producer has to work that hard to get a series together.
I don't think so either. I think there's a lot there. There's a lot of story. There's a lot of lore in this game. It is perfect for, let's say, like HBO because of how gritty it is. And I'm really liking this trend of more games, you know, going to becoming TV series or movies, because in the past, I mean, and it still is somewhat true that it's extraordinarily risky to have a video game move into the TV or movie space because it has been done so badly so many times.
Yeah, that's a wonderful point, by the way, because I think any of us who grew up with the horrible renditions of video games to film or TV, we've all been very hesitant to be excited about anything new. And then mm-hmm. I think with the announcement of the Last of Us TV show, people are like, oh, wow, that actually could work very well as a TV show. And if you have the right producers behind it, it would do great. And the Sonic the Hedgehog movie was a sleeper for me because I went in expectations very low, came yes. out quite surprised at enjoying it. And so to see that this producer is wanting to produce more video game content mm-hmm. into film and TV is truly exciting for execution actually being good.
Right. And I think that the recent games that have become TV shows have been phenomenal, such as The Witcher. I am a huge, huge fan of The Witcher TV show. I thought it was so well done. And I'm, you know, incredibly excited for The Last of Us TV show. I think that there are people that understand now, I guess more than ever, that a lot of these games do have a very compelling story, and changing them to becoming a TV series is just a different medium of kind of the same thing, and there's a lot of elements that really transfer over in the storytelling.
Yeah, that's a great point. I'm surprised I didn't mention The Witcher, because when you said it, I was like, what am I doing? I'm not thinking of The Witcher.
The Witcher, come on.
It's so good. Like, it just, I think it's also too, when you see like graphic novels or books get the translation and it works well, mm-hmm. Like Game of Thrones minus the last two seasons, you would right. say, you know, why can't video games get the same transition? And I think that's a lot of the time due to what you and I have chatted about it before is, are the people who are telling these stories actual gamers? Did they grow up with the IP in that medium?
Right. I think most of the time, no, which is why they've failed so badly. And I think it's important to also have actors in some way that are, well, ideally you'd have an actor that has played the game or is familiar with games. I don't think it's necessary, but I think it does, you know, add a nice touch of nuance and that they really understand, you know, what the world it is that they live in. I thought that The Witcher did a great job of adding video game elements when Geralt is just like picking herbs by himself in silence, or like he yeah. throws a rock to distract like an enemy guard. Every gamer watching yeah. that is like, I've totally done that in video games. That yep. is such a video game thing to do. Like this yeah. is, you know, it really, you know, like brings it to light and adds a new element that otherwise wouldn't be there.
Yeah, and that's also something that I think speaks volumes when you think of like Henry Cavill is he is a gamer. I mean, mm-hmm. he talks about it. That is an aspect of his life that he's always grown up on. He said that the moment he got the opportunity, like he was campaigning for it, he wanted it really badly when he knew it was happening. And when he got it, he went back through and played the entire game. And though, you know, he wanted to make Geralt his own, he really tried to stick to emulating what had already been so successful in the game. Mm-hmm. And that was something to me as just as a consumer and even as an actor that I appreciated so much, was that he was willing to like go, you know what, I'm going to make this my own, but maintain the same integrity that people have like enjoyed about Geralt from the games.
Right, and when we were in the studio, TVT, talking about the Last of Us show, we were talking about how hopefully a lot of the original, you know, voice actors might be able to have, you know, some part of the new show, whether maybe they're not playing their own character, but maybe a side character or a supporting character, or otherwise still, you know, bring that narrative and bring the world that they understand so well into these series. I think it makes a big difference, and it makes it exciting for non-gamers to watch as well, because when you're watching a show or a movie, you're buying into the world of whatever that is. You're not necessarily, you know, nitpicking who's a gamer, who's not, like are these choices good? Like, no, you're just like in, you're just like trying to be in it and trying to like experience the yeah. world as they experience the world.
That's a great point too. And I think all video game companies, I hope they're open to this happening and being done right. Because mm-hmm. if a show like Disco Elysium is successful and many consumers of that show have no idea it's based on a game, they themselves could venture into becoming gamers, which is mm-hmm. just a benefit for the gaming industry, because they loved that so much, they were willing to go play games now and invest time in consuming more of the story. It just, the overall health of the gaming industry benefits from this type of synergy with the film and TV industry.
That's a good point. I think that a lot of people who did watch The Witcher didn't know it was a game. You know, it just comes up recommended on your Netflix, and it's not...
Yeah.
They don't make it very clear that it's from a game, which was originally based on a book, I believe. But
yes.
A lot of people didn't know, but, you know, once they did see the show, they were like, oh, well, I really enjoyed this. Like, I need more Witcher content, please. Where can I get this? And people said, well, like, The Witcher 3 game, and it, you know, boosted sales astronomically, really, for The Witcher 3. And I agree that it's a great way to, you know, get more people into the gaming space, into the gaming industry, because the gaming industry is so huge and so lucrative, but for some reason it's had a lot of trouble kind of breaking into the mainstream.
Yeah, that's true. And that's another thing that we've talked about as well, especially with the next gen consoles coming up this year, is just video games still kind of just get a bad rep in the general public, but they're growing more and more to being respected and understood as, like, yeah, well, if I have a cell phone and I've downloaded, you know, what, Candy Crush or Angry Birds, I myself am now participating in the gaming industry, whether I like it or not. So, you know, that's a perspective that's shifting. And I think maybe like one or two generations after us, it's going to be just... something like Ready Player One wouldn't surprise me, because I think so many generations in two iterations of it will come up with this type of understanding of gaming and how it's necessary in our lives.
I think a lot of people, as you said, don't really understand gaming. Like, I know so many people that play a ton of Candy Crush, or they play a ton of Sims, but they would never consider themselves like a game. Like, they're like, I'm not a gamer. I just, you know, have like 600 hours in The Sims, but like, I'm not a gamer, it's The Sims. And it's like, that's a video game. Like, you're
a gamer.
And
that's a lot of time. Yeah. That's a great observation. You kind of just want to be like, can I go through your like playlist and just see how many games you've played to help you understand you are a gamer?
Right, you are one.
Welcome to the community.
Welcome. And it really doesn't help that a lot of gamers do kind of shun mobile players. Like, I make some jokes like, oh, like mobile players, but I understand and recognize that they are legitimate. They are legitimate gamers. But I think because a lot of the gaming community doesn't, they don't consider it real for whatever reason. I think it also just, you know, further polarizes people, and it further, you know, keeps gaming from being a uniting thing. And it's just finding subdivisions. And it's like, we all want this to go into the mainstream so we all make more money and have better games. And it's, you know, there aren't these negative connotations associated.
Yeah, and that's you said something that it's meant to be together. I think that's something, you know, for me, like I've talked about before, is like when I was younger and kind of just like went through a lot of bullying and persecution for whatever reason, it was the gaming community that actually embraced me. Mm-hmm. It was other gamers that didn't, you know, look at me for what I was in school, because they, you know, met me through Xbox Live or whatever.
Right.
And they treated me like, hey, you're just a part of this and we're achieving a goal together. Let's be respectful for one another and enjoy the time working together. And that was something I always recognized. And that's why I love the gaming community so much. And it's just been a deep passion.
I really want to see more of that, and more of that, you know, wholesome culture, really, and people embracing other gamers, regardless of what console they play, which is our next topic of conversation.
Yes, as we are going to kind of dive in, as I'm sure we're all wondering if we're going to jump into the next gen consoles and talk about the major differences between the Xbox Series X and the PlayStation 5.
So, if you've been paying close attention to the specs on next-gen consoles, you've probably realized that the PS5 and Xbox Series X share a lot in common. From the AMD-built CPU and GPU to the ultra-fast solid-state drives, both consoles are sure to deliver similar top-end performance.
And yeah, Kane, I can't agree. Let's all be wholesome. So, as she was saying, now that we've finally seen the PlayStation 5 console and the extent of what it can do, as well as several third-party titles running on the Xbox Series X, more differences between the two systems have become clear, and we'll even get more info during Microsoft's first-party games showcase, which is coming up in July.
Notably, the consoles have differences in their exclusive games, subscription services, controllers, backwards compatibility, expandable storage, and form factor. The price for both consoles has yet to be announced.
And let's go ahead and take a closer look at the differences in the solid-state drives and power.
So both consoles will use solid-state drives for ultra-fast storage, taking advantage of NVMe technology that's currently available on high-end PCs. However, internal storage capacity will differ slightly, as the Xbox Series X comes with a 1TB SSD, while the PS5 has an 825GB SSD.
And as we all know, games are only getting larger in terms of install size. Warzone. Call of Duty Warzone.
Looking at you.
So you'll most likely need to consider external storage, especially if you're going with a disk driveless console. And the Xbox Series X will have a proprietary 1TB SSD drive from Seagate available, and users will see no loss in speed between the internal and external SSDs.
On the other hand, the PlayStation 5 gives you more options. It supports certain M.2 NVMe drives currently on the market, as the console features an internal M.2 expansion slot. However, Sony system architect Mark Cerny stated that your SSD needs to be as fast as the one built into your PS5. Other USB drives can be used as an external storage, and you'll be able to play backward-compatible PS4 games directly off of them.
And regarding the difference in power between the consoles, on paper, they have different amounts of teraflops, or TFLOPs, which is the general estimate of graphics processing power. Looking only at the number, at this number, would be an oversimplification of matters. And we don't know if this will really translate to a difference in fidelity between games, as the information is that the PlayStation 5 has 10.26 teraflops, of power, while the Xbox Series X boasts a 12.18 teraflops.
Both consoles are capable of ray tracing, 4K resolution, and eventually 8K, and 120 FPS, though these graphical features largely depend on how developers build their games. Both consoles use custom AMD hardware and Navi-based RDNA 2 GPU technology. So what's the big difference? For right now, it's just the numbers like clock speeds and compute units from what we know so far, and we'll have to see these consoles in action once we have them.
So, you know, it begs the question, does the larger number with the Xbox make a bigger difference in choice of which console you should get? And do we think that'll actually have an impact on sales?
I was wondering what the chat thinks on this, because personally, we've seen that the PlayStation 5 games look a lot more graphically rich than the Xbox Series X ones, but technically the Xbox is the more powerful console, and it also has, you know, more storage. So I really wonder what this means for consumers. I've also noticed a difference in the PlayStation. While it has technically, you know, the lower specs or the lower TFLOPs, lower teraflops, you can use your own SSD, but you do have to be aware of the specifications of that to make sure that it is compatible, versus the Xbox seems more you can just swap out hard drives with them. It's really easy. You don't have to know anything about the actual technology that goes behind it.
Yeah, and Gamer, you know, was saying if the PS5 doesn't have a 1440p high FPS support, it's a no-go. And that was something both Microsoft and Sony have addressed, is that each will be able to achieve 4K with 60 frames per second smooth. And then also said that it is possible that it'll be 2K at 120. So that is something we're going to have to see it in action. You know, you can say that, but let's actually see, you know, it pull off. And if they do pull it off, that's going to be very impressive for a console to be able to pump out.
I think so too. And personally, I'm leaning more towards the PlayStation 5 because of a lot of the exclusives like Ratchet and Clank. I want to be able to play Ghost of Tsushima, even though that's coming out for PlayStation 4. I think that the PlayStation 5 reveal was phenomenal. I thought it was, they did an incredible job. And meanwhile, on Xbox's side, I think Hellblade is a cool game, but I don't need to buy a console specifically to play that game. I'd rather just wait even a year, you know, for that to come out on PC. And I'm personally not that, you know, excited about Halo Infinite. Sorry to any Halo Infinite fans in the chat. But I think that PlayStation 5 just really has the better exclusives as well.
Yeah, I would also say I am too on the ready to buy a PS5, ready for the pre-orders, because there are other features with the PlayStation 5 that, you know, Tim Sweeney even addressed, which was the speed that is in the PlayStation 5 and why they're working directly with Sony, is because the processing power, though it is not as large in teraflops, the actual information that is being transferred for them, they were recognizing that the focus is more on the developers actually executing more information faster versus, hey, you have all this space, you know, do something with it. That kind of like Xbox has done, where they've just kind of like left it up in the air. Because the other features that come with the PlayStation 5, like the Tempest audio, the 3D
and
audio,
the haptics
is
and the controller.
And the haptic feedback with the controller. Yeah, the new controller. I mean, if you think about that, the Xbox is going to give you the Xbox Series, you know, X controller that you're like, oh, this is just the Elite Series 2 now in the Xbox Series X. And Sony's saying, you're getting a new controller.
Right, a brand new controller, a dual sense because of the, you know, the senses that, that you feel, this the sensing that'll happen. And there were even games at the PlayStation 5 reveal that were created by animators, you know, not even game developers, because a lot of animators saw, you know, how easy it is to actually develop with this new technology. A lot of the graphics that you see are, they're more generated by the actual machine versus being put on the developer themselves. And I think that the PS5 is a really robust system, and for me, it's just hard to compare, and I'm thinking maybe the Xbox isn't as developer-friendly.
Yeah, that's a really interesting observation, because you said something, and then I looked at what Saul Goodman was saying there, too, is that games are king, and when you look at the exclusives, and you know the kind of games that are going to be coming out for the PlayStation 5, like Horizon Zero West, you know, the Ratchet and Clank titles. Let's talk about the next God of War when that drops. I mean, we know that these games that are going to be coming out for this console, people are going to want, because they're going to want the next gen version of these games. Like, it, can you wrap your head around what is the next God of War installation going to be like on the PlayStation 5?
That's a great point. For me, when I saw this Ratchet and Clank trailer with like the ray tracing on Clank and just the speed in which, you know, the machine actually loaded the game, you know, you're jumping through portals, you're going through entirely different worlds, and there are no loading times at all, really. I know the Xbox also boasts no loading times, but I think the games that at least I've seen so far haven't really taken advantage of that and haven't, you know, done this like crazy portal jumping into different worlds. It's just maybe like a bigger environment you're in. I don't know. From the Xbox reveal, I didn't, there weren't that many games that really truly impressed me.
Yeah.
My standards are very high. All the games were wonderful, but there's hard competition out there.
Yeah, there is. And that's something too that I was like thinking of with when you looked at the PlayStation event was, these games look like animated movies. Like, these feel like full
this
animated
like
films
Pixar.
That you're interacting with. Yeah. And with the Xbox Series X live event that they had with their third-party titles was kind of... I wasn't, like, super impressed as I was with the majority of the titles that Sony showed, where I was like, I just want to run around this world and learn about it and see it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And Xbox Series X was just kind of like, we got games? And you were just like... Hey!
You're like, yeah, you do have some games. I have a question for chat. If you're leaning more towards the Xbox Series X or the PS5, if you're looking to purchase a new console, from what I've seen of a lot of Xbox fans, and I used to be like this, I think my sister's still kind of like this, it's like, well, Xbox, because I've always been with Xbox and PlayStation sucks, but there's no actual reason beyond that besides just that, like, empty brand loyalty. I'm wondering, for Xbox fans, maybe you like Xbox because of the Game Pass. Maybe you like Xbox, you know, because you can share games that way, because you just like how the controller feels better, because you do like the exclusives more. I'm really curious to see, because for me, I'm thinking PS5 all the way.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. I was someone who played on an Xbox 360. I made the jump from PS2 to 360 as like a committed Xbox fanboy, and once the One and the Four were out, I switched immediately because of just the power of the Four. And then now, looking at it again, you know, just paying attention to it, it just feels like Sony has just become this monster. And their PlayStation VR 2, whatever that is going to be, the patents that keep getting leaked and people are talking about, they're talking about this like being like the next top tier VR headset, and it's going to be for console. Oh my god, I'm so committed to Sony all the way now.
Me too, especially with PlayStation Studios, I believe was the name of their like umbrella of exclusives. They wanted to attach that name to really show the quality of their games and, you know, extend that that great public perception of it to their other games to really show you that you are getting a quality game when you're buying PlayStation exclusive games. Versus Xbox is working a lot more with developers. There was that game Grounded, I believe. Was it the It's a Bug's Life, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids?
Yes.
Game that looks really good, but I think that they haven't really branded those as, you know, Xbox, developed by, you know, Xbox Studios or under the Xbox umbrella. And I think that could do them some good to, you know, also show that they are, you know, great. They have great game developers as well.
That's a good point. Yeah, it's something we've speculated on is Microsoft really focusing on the Xbox Series X as being, you know, a real competitor with the PlayStation 5? Or is it more so like, hey, we're going to be at a price point that is going to allow you to experience the feeling of next gen. You know, it's like a comparison would be like virtual reality headsets. Like if you want the top tier VR headsets, it's the Valve Index. That is where you're going to get the most immersive experience possible. Mm-hmm. But if you want to go with like a Windows mixed reality headset, you'll still get a pretty overall good experience, but it's not going to compare to the Valve Index. I kind of feel like that's what's happening.
That's what I initially thought and what I still think, I guess, is my personal prediction that the PlayStation 5, you know, has all these exclusives. Maybe the Xbox will come in at a little less expensive. I was reading some articles and poking around, and a lot of general like speculations or guesstimates do still put the Xbox at around $500. So I don't know if maybe the Xbox is going to be at $500. I don't know if there's a discless Xbox or if there's just the one model versus with, you know, the PlayStation you do have, you know, an option. But I doubt the PlayStation discless version will still be any less than $499.
Yeah, and size, we have to just admit that both of them are just a massive, massive piece of machine. There's just no doubt about it. Like, I love the comparison of the Xbox Series X looks like a trash can and the PlayStation 5 just looks like a giant router.
It's a massive router.
It's true. They're huge, but that's because the tech they've got to use now in order to give us the experience that we're going to get with these next-gen games.
Right.
It's just, it's the way it's going to be.
It's the way it's going to be, you know, with these like incredible graphics that you see in these games, you know, how they really push the hardware. You know, you do have to have a huge machine, especially with the like the cooling that happens because, you know, with the machinery in there, it heats up. So it's like really important to have ventilation as well, as part of why, you know, the consoles are so big. And for some people, like Coom said, it comes down to you just like how it looks. Like, oh, I just like how the Xbox looks better. Like, I think it just looks better. Like, that might be it for a lot of consumers. It might be about aesthetics, just personal preference, you know, beyond some, you know, deep-rooted analysis of, like, which one actually has the better technology or has the better exclusives.
Yeah, and that is a... like, to Saul Goodman's point earlier, is that games are king when we're talking about gaming.
Yeah.
And so what we should expect to see that will come out, you know, I'm also paying attention to what developers are saying. And developers seem to be saying that the PlayStation 5 is the easier streamlined console development console. So that's something too, is like, if I'm a developer and it's going to take me months to work on a title, but it'll take me less time to do so with one over the other, I will want to put in where it'll take me less time.
Exactly.
Because you know what I mean? Time is money. So if it's less, then I'm saving and I'm earning more over a longer period of time. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see some of that space kind of shift where people who used to develop more for Xbox or Microsoft shift and move over to Sony.
Me either. And a game we're talking about next is a huge one, as Marvel's Avengers Free Roam is now explained and players will be able to fly everywhere.
So if you are a comic book nerd like me and excited about a Marvel video game like this, it is not technically an open world game. So instead what they're doing is that they opt for a large hub zone that players will be able to complete main and side objectives along with a number of activities, including being able to free roam in these areas. And to explain what players can expect more, the game's Warzone director, Philippe Theron opens up a bit on Marvel's Avengers Free Roam, along with how characters can travel in the game.
Taking part in a recent Reddit Ask Me Anything, also known as an AMA, Philip confirmed that players will be able to free roam between objectives, along with what kinds of activities they can do. There was a question of, are there going to be times where we can freely explore regions peacefully, or is it just constant action? And he said that in between objectives, you are free to roam anywhere as you please and to look for points of interest around the level. These can be allies to rescue, bounty enemies to defeat for loot, hidden caches, secret AIM stockpiles of resources, or you could raid AIM's depots where they store gear. Typically, those rewards are defended, but you can roam around the environment without constantly fighting if you want to just admire the scenery or have fun doing traversal.
And then another question that was posed was, when we deploy to a war zone, how does that work? Will we be selecting a mission to pursue and then have free roam over the map until we complete the objective? Or can we select an option on the map to free roam the area without a mission objective? And also, can players split up from each other and go into different corners of the map on their own? Or is it one of those situations where we have to stick together? And the answer was this: when you pick a mission and choose your hero, you will be inside the war zone that you've selected until the mission is completed. You can explore up until the point where the final objective is completed, and at that point, we will return to the Quinjet where you can select another mission. And players can absolutely split up as they wish, but keep in mind, if you do go off alone, you could get overwhelmed by enemies.
Therion also confirmed that players can expect different types of regions, all while teasing that there are still more to come. Region-wise, we will have cities, forests, deserts, the Arctic, underwater, in orbit, and some others that aren't revealed yet. Inside those regions, you will see everything from wilderness to AIM structures, and of course, urban landscapes in cities.
And of course, with there being different heroes that can travel differently, one has to consider how they would balance things out, as those who can fly would most likely reach an objective faster than those who can't. Luckily, Phil had an answer to this and confirmed that they have balanced the characters out in terms of speed when reaching objectives.
This game continues to amaze me as to how extensive it is, as to how much there is to do in this game. I am blown away by the fact that there is an underwater and an in-orbit region, yes, in addition to just like normal landscapes. I am maybe slightly skeptical. I have to see it to believe it with some of these regions, because they just sound so impressive.
Yeah, that's a great point. I have to believe it until I see it. It makes me think about like when I play an open world game like GTA Online. How often do I leave certain areas and go into areas, you know, unexplored? It's not too often that I go into certain regions that mm-hmm. I care to explore, because it's just like, right, it's like, oh yeah, it's just mountainous here and maybe I'll end up here if I'm running away from the police. Mm-hmm. So this concept makes sense that they're like, we've kind of like honed in on a certain area. We've made it large enough and vast enough for you to explore. And that allows us to really kind of like not be open world, but to feel that sense of scale still be present.
I think that that's actually a really good way to do it. I mean, you made a good point that sometimes if you're in an open world game, you kind of wander to an area where there's nothing there, and you're just kind of like, where am I? Are there any cities? You know, like eventually you'll stumble upon something, but it might take a really long time. I am still in the middle of playing Breath of the Wild like a full year later.
Oh my God.
And I do get to a point where I'm thinking I really want to just go explore the world, and then it's just 20 minutes of like trying to like climb a certain mountain and then slipping down because it's raining, and then I have to wait for the rain to clear. And there is a point where open world games are so open that it's just like a struggle bus.
Yeah, and that's a really good point, because there was something recently came out that some people were saying we need to make games shorter, right? And it was like, we don't need really long games. And I think there's a point to what you just said, and just something I saw Crispy put in is like, I don't think I'll ever finish Breath of the Wild. It's kind of the same feeling I had when playing Skyrim, was like, I don't think I'm ever going to like play every side mission in Skyrim. Same with Witcher 3. There was a lot I skipped in order to push through the story and the experience, that it's kind of like, I'm okay with this if the scale is still there, that there's always something to do, mm-hmm. you know? And I think with these superheroes, it's one of those where it's like, we know, at least we hear, that the information processed with next-gen gaming will be able to handle this.
Yes.
does it really actually handle it? We don't know because we don't have the hardware to really show us that it can.
Right, the games, you know, there are very few finished games that can really show if the hardware can, you know, handle it once it's all said and done. And you made a good point about how some developers have been talking about actually making games smaller. For example, Assassin's Creed Valhalla is going to be a little smaller than Assassin's Creed Odyssey because Odyssey was a great game. I didn't get very far in it. I think I maybe put like 50 hours into it, and I felt like I barely made a dent in that game. And part of the feedback that they got from gamers was that the game was so huge that it's cool that there's so much environment, but I also don't want to be like running across ancient Greece for 20 minutes and doing all these kind of busy quests that don't really progress the story, and it's just kind of like something to do.
Yeah. There is one thing, though, that I think as we hear that there's this balance, right, of travel, and this is a question for chat as well, is what method of travel are we looking forward to most? You know, if you think about it, you have flying, there's obviously going to be some sort of running, sprinting, and I would say when I think of someone like the Hulk, there's going to be jumping, like leaping, large amounts of distance.
I think I was going to say flying, but after I play Iron Man VR, I don't think flying is going to be nearly as exciting as it is in that game. I think like leaping would be cool. We were talking about how unfortunately Black Widow, her skill set didn't seem that exciting in this game. She's just like running. She's just like running around, and I'm like, okay, well I can run around in pretty much any game.
Hi, I'm here.
Right.
You know, like, and as you see the Hulk come by and Thor fly by, and even like Miss Marvel doing her thing,
honestly,
and then she's like, I'm
cool
over here with pistols.
Yeah. And you're like, pistols usually are cool, but compared to everyone else.
Now we know.
Not right now. Sorry, Black Widow.
There was a Hulk game that came out a while back that I really liked, and that had that feel of like you could run really fast. You could run up the walls of the buildings, and then you could leap large, you know, distances. So I hope that comes into this game as well, because it's just so much fun to just be barreling through the city.
Right.
Everything's running by you, and you jump, and maybe you're, you know, moving by Iron Man, who's being played by your friend, and you're just like sailing through as they're flying by.
Oh, yeah. How old was this Hulk game? I don't think I ever knew there was a Hulk game.
Yeah, I think this was Xbox One, maybe the not Xbox One, but like the OG Xbox had this title.
Exactly old.
Right now. Come on, Microsoft,
come
fix
on,
these
Microsoft.
Names.
Even the Series X, when people talk about the Series S, I'm like, did you mean to say X? Like, did you mean S? I can't hear what you're saying.
My brain can't handle it. It can't handle it. Yeah. This is, again, as you said in the beginning, is like there's just more information that comes out about this game that I'm like, I hope you deliver. I really hope you deliver.
Mm-hmm.
Please deliver everything that you're saying you can.
What they've shown from this game so far has all looked great. There was a 25 or so minute, you know, reveal that was a walkthrough of the War Zones, which is like the multiplayer co-op aspect of this game. And it's truly impressive. And I really hope that it's as fun as it looks, because it seems like a lot of different things, a lot of features have gone into this game, from how you customize like your emotes, your celebratory emotes, your look, your skill set is even different. So my Miss Marvel is going to be different from someone else's Miss Marvel because of, you know, the skills that are built up there, in addition to just the different ways that you can play with those characters.
Exactly. The skill trees are massive. And that's the part that it's going to be exciting, because if I have a friend who's like, oh, I play Iron Man, and I have another friend who's like, oh, I play Iron Man, and I see the differences in how
they're
play.
They're not the same Iron Man.
Yeah, you know what I mean? That's going to be such a unique experience of like, oh, wow, I'm seeing a different game, but it's based on their choice. That freedom is to me, beautiful that they're putting into this and not trying to, you know, give you that too many guardrails. You know, sometimes games can are just like, this is the path you move in. And as a gamer, you're like, give me some variety, please. I'm thirsty for it.
My Iron Man is better than your Iron Man.
Yeah, exactly. That's a great way to put it. Yeah. 1v1 me, bro.
1v1 me, Iron Man. Since we only have about 10 minutes left, I'm not sure if this will be our last story, but if anyone has played The Man of Medan, we have a first look at Little Hope, which is the next installation in the Dark Anthology Pictures.
And it's a little creepy. So Little Hope is the second episode in Supermassive's Dark Pictures Anthology, and it's been pushed back to autumn, but you can get a quick fix of time travel and witchcraft now thanks to this raw footage of the horror romp and action. Let's take a look at it.
Let's have a look at this, and let's also put some volume on so everyone can react to this as well.
You played the Man of Medan, right?
I did. I was a big fan of that game. Some articles, I think this article that, you know, revealed this news called it like tacky, like cheesy horror. And I think it was, I wouldn't call it cheesy, but it's definitely, I guess, like traditional fun horror that I think a lot of people will enjoy, even if you're not, you know, a horror fan.
True. Yeah. I did like Until Dawn and the Until Dawn experience. I need to go and play Man of Medan. I need to go and do it.
It's like watching a movie with your friends, and I think there's a co-op way to do it as well. So let's take a look at Little Hope.
Peggy 18.
It's coming from the town.
Did the old fucker just lock us out?
He was weird, that old guy.
Sure was something off about him. Why come to Creepy Central just to get a top up?
What does that mean?
Heading into Little Hope feels like our only option.
They always have that one random actor that you're like, I recognize this person, and then they're in it, and you're like, what? Okay, all right. Who is this? I don't know, but I know that face.
I think we're going the right way.
What I like about the Dark Pictures anthology games versus, you know, some other kind of choose your own adventure games is your choices actually make like a huge difference. Yeah. In some games you make different choices, but then it all ends up being the same ending, but it really like changes a lot to this game.
Yeah. Their butterfly effect engine that they talked about within Until Dawn, I was like, you guys could just keep telling stories all you want.
keep at it.
The replayability is huge.
So I'm going to talk a little bit over this trailer since there's not a lot of dialogue. So Little Hope frequently transitions between quiet exploration, dialogue, cutscenes, and QTEs. And just in this 1 7-minute sequence, it jumps around quite a bit, but never lingers too long on one thing, keeping you on your toes, and it's all pretty seamless.
So the episodes were originally meant to appear every 6 months, but Lost Hope has taken a bit longer. Once it launches in autumn, it will have been over a year between them. Thankfully, they're standalone and feature a completely different set of characters and horrible fates, so the first episode won't need to be fresh in your mind.
And the first game, Man of Medan, that I played, it was about 3 or 4 hours long, which I really like shorter games because I feel like I have so many games to get through. Especially horror. Oh my gosh, don't make me sit through a long horror game. It took me, I think, about 8 to 10 hours to complete Outlast.
Looks
and
like
it usually
kind of
takes people, I think, like 6 or 5
warning,
because
perhaps.
I was just like so stressed the whole time that I didn't want to actually progress the story.
Significance.
Yeah.
Wherever it is.
And that's something I remember from Until Dawn. Was Until Dawn had me on the edge of my seat. I was like, what decision do I make? I don't know what to do here. And
do
now
this.
It's just...
I've heard more than enough. Thank
you. Don't make me do this for hours, please.
Right. This guy does look familiar. Were you talking about this guy?
I didn't scare you, did I?
Yeah, again, it's like, I know this actor.
I don't know.
I can't place it, but I know him, and that's happened in every single one.
A lot of people still really believe in this kind of stuff.
Yeah, who is he?
After tonight, I thought
you
might
be joining. I think I have to change the caps. There's like a...
Just because
I have to change the bot. Doesn't let anyone be excited.
Doesn't mean I'm...
Oh, yeah. Caps is excitement, and the bot's like, stop yelling!
Catch up with the rest. I don't want to spend any more time with this disgusting thing.
Oh.
The other part...
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember Alan Wake?
Yes. Well, I saw the trailer of it because of that... There's that new game that's coming out that looks like Alan Wake.
Yeah. This... I just always get these Alan Wake vibes whenever I see this kind of stuff. And that game had me on the edge of my seat. Oh.
I think this is everything I honestly want from a horror game, where it's like, I want the mist, I want the fog, I don't care if it's cliche. Like, you know, give me the teenagers, like, stumbling around in the woods with a flashlight.
Yep. And Orpheus said something that is just where they are so strong in their, what's under the hood of this game is just, you'll want to play it again and again and see what decision affects what outcome.
I can't see
And then go back through and do it again and go back through and do it again. I loved how when they showed Until Dawn,
I definitely saw someone.
Look at how much changes
100%.
Just from a simple of a yes to a no and open this door versus that door and how those two choices unlock all these other possibilities.
And how it changes a lot, as you said, with the replayability is, you know, is a big thing for me. I am a big horror game fan, but there are still a lot more that I have to, you know, that I have to actually play, such as Silent Hill. Like, how can I call myself a horror gamer if I've never played Silent Hill?
Yes.
But it's definitely on my list. And this is a question for chat of how often do you play horror games if you're not a horror fan? I know a lot of friends who they say they hate horror, but they've still, you know, they've all played Outlast for some reason. Like they've all played like some of these staples.
That's a great question because I like watching horror films. Playing horror games is just an entirely different, you know, mindset. And it's like, I don't want to open this door. Whereas like in the movie, it's like, yes, you victim, open the door. You know what I mean? It's not me.
Yes, it's not me
controlling
doing
you.
It.
Yeah.
It's is it Will Poulter from Bandersnatch?
I think that is the guy from Bandersnatch.
Yeah, let me pull up his face again.
Which is just like perfect
like
because Bandersnatch and this are very similar of
choose your own
storytelling. Yeah.
Where like something horrible will happen to you.
Yeah. He's going to become like the choose your own adventure actor like Chloe Grace Moretz is in every single reboot. You can think of. She's always in a reboot. She is all the time. If it's a reboot, she's in it.
She's in it. Jeez. With these games, I'm a big fan of choose your own adventure games. I was really sad to hear when Telltale went under, but now it's back. But I haven't played its games since. But the Wolf Among Us 2. We don't know. I think when the release date is
when
for
it's
that
coming
one,
out, but it's back in the works. They've reunited. They're supposedly under new leadership, which is important. And that was a story that when I got done with it, and I was like, "How long ago was that?" And it's just like I can't believe I haven't been able to dive back into this universe because you're right. Telltale Games was doing an amazing job with these choose your own adventures in their QuickTime.
So the last topic we had, I think we'll push over to tomorrow, but maybe we can give you a little bit of a teaser about what we'll be talking about, because this is a big discussion that has been happening on the internet.
Yeah, and that is that there are rumors of new streaming services, Brime, Altair, and Spotify Gaming. And there is a lot to jump in with this, but this shouldn't surprise any of us as some of the people behind these entities. It makes sense with COVID and everything that we're going to that we would be seeing more of these come to light.
Right. And some of these are rumors. I've seen certain allegations of like, hey, this Twitter is actually just run by like a couple of kids. There's nothing actually to it. It's just kids who know how to, you know, gain traction and get gamers excited. But it's all coming at a time when Mixer just closed. And, you know, those streamers are going over to Facebook Gaming. And there's this whole rise of all these new platforms. But to me, I'm thinking, is this the best time to start a platform? Because Microsoft, with all its money and all its resources and two of the top streamers in the game, like that company just went under.
Yeah. What is the if you can do it?
Oh, they'll come. They will come.
Yeah, like I guess if you build it, they will come.
You can do it, but should you do it?
Yeah, that there it is. You can. Should you? Will they come if you build it? I don't know. There's just like a lot up in the air there. I think what would matter most is how in which they implement the service to feel like it is actually something worth, you know, jumping from Twitch to go to or YouTube Gaming or some of the ones that are already there. I didn't think TikTok was going to take off, but because that was an app that I was like, what's the difference between that and Instagram? TikTok has taken over by storm. So I think these places have that kind of mindset.
That reminds me of like Warzone. Like I thought Warzone would have been nothing. And Warzone is huge. And I think that just because some of these companies have failed, really, it doesn't mean that all of them will. And I think that there is a, you know, a potential for these companies to grow. Personally, maybe it's just because I mainly stream on Twitch, but a lot of the concerns that the community does have, you know, about maybe TOS enforcement, about, you know, discoverability, about monetization, when I really do sit down and think about it, I'm like, well, I don't see any other platform doing this better. And when Twitch hands me a survey that's like, oh, well, like, what could we do to improve? I'm like, I actually don't know what you could do to improve.
Right.
So yeah. I don't know if, you know, like, there's really no reason for me to switch over to another platform, you know, unless, you know, one of these companies is going to pay me a lot of money to go there. And some of them will, and some of them might.
Yeah. And that'll be something that we dive into tomorrow. But this does bring us to the end of our first episode of Daily Gaming News here on Twitch TV, which we were so excited to dive right back in and keep the gaming news train going.
Thank you so much for joining us. Marone and I are so excited and happy that all of you are here. We're really psyched that you are supporting us on our new venture of having our own news show called The Daily Gaming News. Where can everyone find your social media?
So if you would like to, there is a slight variation. If just on Twitch, it's Marone with 2 underscores. And then, you know, with Instagram, it's Christopher Marone, because Marone is taken by a very popular European musician. And then for Twitter, it's Marone, but how you would spell it out.
But how you spell it out, and that's all in the panels as well.
Yeah.
There's a chat command with some of that social media. My information is also in the panels. Are you going to be streaming anytime soon, Marone?
I probably am. I've actually got a ton of wins recently in Warzone. I'm closing in on 80. So that is probably going to happen soon, but I'm in the process of moving. So it's going to probably be a couple of days that once that's set up, that I'll be jumping back into streaming some gameplay. But yeah, trying to keep these Warzone wins live.
Yeah, check them out. And I won't be streaming immediately after this, but I'll probably hop back on sometime tonight. But I'll keep you all posted in the Discord. But thank you so much for joining our first show. We are so glad to have you here.
Thank you so much, everybody. This isn't possible without you. We're really excited to keep this going and to see all of your wonderful e-faces and emotes in the chat and discussing everything going on in the gaming industry with us. For Daily Gaming News, I am Marone.
I am Kaisa. Thank you so much, and have a good one out there.
Bye, everybody.